I practiced crying so I wouldn't cry here. I don't know if that's going to work or not. Many's the time I felt mistaken and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken and certainly misused. Oh, but I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm just weary to my bones. Still, you don't expect to be bright and bon vivant so far away from home. So far away from home. I don't know a soul who's not been battered. I don't have a friend who feels at ease. I don't know a dream that's not been shattered or driven to its knees. But it's all right, it's all right. For we've lived so well, so long. Still, when I think of the road we're traveling on, I wonder what's gone wrong. I can't help it. I wonder what's gone wrong. Well, these words, some of us are old enough to remember, were written by Paul Simon over 50 years ago in a particularly challenging time of our country's life. The words were descriptive then, and I think they're prophetic because we feel some of those same things today. We're in a similar mood. And into this time, crises occur that take our breath away. One of those crises was just a week and a half ago in our city of Burnsville, Minnesota. I serve as a Burnsville chaplain for the police and fire departments. Sometimes people say, well, what does a chaplain do? My response these days is a chaplain spends some time with people in the worst moments of the worst days of their lives. And Sunday was one of those days for us, all of us. You know, I recall one call out just a few years ago. It was early in the morning. I went to the home, connected with the officer in charge, and was given some basic information about the woman that I was to talk to. Her partner had died in his sleep. He had decided that several months earlier, that he would not use drugs anymore. And he didn't. Until he did, the night before, and he died. And the officer pointed to the porch and said, she's out there. You can go talk to her now. She's expecting you. So I went and introduced myself and asked if we could talk, if she could tell me what happened. She wanted to talk, but she was beside herself. She was chain smoking, and her hands were shaking with all of the stress that she felt. But she told me her story. And then it was quiet. We waited in silence. And all of a sudden, very loudly, she said, Jesus Christ, why did this happen? Silence again. And then just half a minute later, she said the same thing with the same intensity, the same volume. Jesus Christ, why did this happen? I asked her, do you know what it sounds like when you say that? No, what? I said, well, it sounds like a prayer. What? I said, well, it sounds like a prayer. Would you like me to offer a prayer for you right now? Oh, yes. Yes, I would. So I waited and then I prayed. Jesus Christ, why did this happen? Jesus Christ, why did this happen? said, Lord, even as we ask this, we know there are no answers that would satisfy. But honestly, it's a question in our minds and on our hearts. So we ask you, stay close. Give us even a glimmer of hope that we can make it through this. We so need you right now. Well, now she wasn't smoking anymore and her hands weren't shaking. We just sat quietly and talked for a while longer. You know, people of faith have always been familiar with hard questions, impossible questions. And God is familiar with people who ask impossible questions with whatever emotion we have when we ask them. The Old Testament prophet said, how long must I call for help? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? That was Habakkuk. Job, we all know Job, suffering prophet, suffering leader. Job says, why have you made me your target, God? And Job was the guy that had everything. And then he lost everything. And he kept his faith. Amazing. You know, Job was the oldest book in the Bible, first written. So these questions have been around for a long, they've been around forever. Suffering has been around forever. Evil has been around forever. Grief and loss have been around forever. So Job speaks for all of us at one time or another. Sometimes it feels like we're a target. It's not fair. The New Testament disciples came upon a man who was born blind. He, of course, was at a terrible disadvantage in life. They asked Jesus, why was this man born blind? I mean, was it his problem or his parents? Crazy question. The answer was, no, neither. It's no one's fault. It just happened. Jesus on the cross, as we know, quoted Psalm 22 when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Why have you left me all alone? We ask God the impossible question of why. But Jesus did, and we do too. We ask God that question. And even asking questions like that directly to God means on some level we believe he exists. And on some level we believe he's actually listening. On some level we believe he'll respond and somehow help us through. On a lighter note, I stopped by the Dairy Queen a while back. It was one of those middle afternoon, hadn't had lunch yet, feeling kind of low energy, kind of blah. So I stopped at the Dairy Queen. That always picks me up, you know. As I sat there pretending to read something and look busy, a young mother and her little boy walked by, and I heard her say as she walked in, today we can each get a Dilly or a Misty. Which would you like, Billy? Billy blurted out, I want a mudslide. And I thought, I like this kid. He had been watching television, of course. Well, his mom said, well, not today, Billy, but we can have a Dilly or a Misty. Which one would you like? I want a mudslide. So I put aside my reading. I thought, this is going to be much more interesting than whatever I was reading. The little guy said loudly, I hate you. Well, now I was getting ready to call one of you guys to come because, you might need, child abuse going on or something. Mom didn't skip a beat, though. She didn't even change her expression. She just said, oh, that's too bad. I don't hate you, I love you. And I'd like to buy you a Dilly or a Misty, but since you're not interested in those two things, I guess we'll have to go. And she gently took his hand and started heading toward the door. All of a sudden you hear him say, Dilly. Oh, would you like a Dilly? You know, I think I'll have one too. Let's go order it. And off they went to the counter. Last I saw them a few minutes later, they were leaving, both eating their treats. He with ice cream running down his wrist. Still like that kid. Well, the point is this. God is at least as understanding as this wise young mom of this lucky young boy. He could say anything. And she said, he's my son. I don't need to discipline him for thinking that he hates me. He'll learn. He'll grow. But he'll learn more if I'm kind to him, even when he's unkind to me. I believe that's the way God treats us. And in our grief, and in our sorrow, in our suffering, we can say anything to him and know that he will be there for us. He understands our thoughts, our deepest emotions and struggles and growing pains. God's love is far stronger than our reactions when we're in grief and suffering. So we ask him why, and we listen, and we reflect on it, and we talk with others who will listen to us, others who won't give us too much advice, and who won't tell us to see things differently, but will just understand what we're experiencing now. You know, not everyone understands grief or realizes the time it takes to get some relief. It's easy to become cynical. I'm an old English major, and Robert Frost was one of my favorite poets. He wrote this poem called Home Burial, where a husband and wife lost their infant son, and they're discussing their feelings and thoughts, and they're not getting along very well. So at one point when the wife is leaving, she says, you know, friends make pretense of following you to the grave, but before one is in it, their minds are turned and making the best of their way back to life and living people and things they understand. We have thousands of people here today. Next week there won't be thousands, but hopefully we each have a few close friends who are there for us and will be there for us. And I can tell you the police and fire communities are very loyal to one another. They will be there for each of the families. I can promise you that. They will be there. A cynic is an idealist who doesn't want to be hurt again. When they've been hurt, they expect to be disappointed each time. Sometimes that's true, but in this case, it won't be. Our faith is a central resource for us as well. God doesn't leave us alone either. Listen to these interesting words from the book of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. We aren't alone. We have each other. We have resources. We have the respect and gratitude of people in our community. And the prophet here lists three images of staying in the faith: flying like an eagle, running and staying strong, and walking without giving up. Now, paradoxically, the eagle is probably the easiest time. Rising up means spreading our wings and allowing the air currents to lift us up. And we're not fighting the wind, we're using the wind. That's why people who have a committed friend, they say, he or she was the wind beneath my wings. That's how I see a lot of the relationships in the place, in the fire communities, the deep friendships that are formed, the being there for each other, the respect, the crazy sense of humor, and the respect in the middle of it, the wind beneath our wings. So these friends make it possible for us to move ahead, make it progress, become successful, make it through difficult times of grief and struggle like these days. We need both our faith and our friends to lift us these days. Running is often difficult until you do it so regularly that you grow into it, and when you do, you can actually enjoy it. It's hard for non-runners to understand. I used to be a runner, 20 pounds and 20 years ago. But you get to the place where you get this high, this runner's high. Again, if you're not a runner, don't even try to understand it. But if you are, you've been there, jogging along mile after mile. And there's a kind of sense of exhilaration that comes. I don't know if Isaiah was a runner or not, but he seemed to understand that. One would think walking would be the most natural and the easiest. Still, if you're exhausted and you don't have reserves of energy, walking can become drudgery, and then it can even feel dangerous. We can question ourselves, wonder if we can make it, feel like there's never-ending corners to turn. Walking long enough can drain our energy, sap our strength, and lower our resolve. Grief can seem never-ending as well. It can go on for much longer than we hoped or expected. The promise is that we can make it through with the power of faith in the presence of one another. God bless us as we heal and grow and grieve and express ourselves to God and to our friends. As we do, we realize that we are not alone, that we can make it. We can slowly and surely grow into hope. May God help us to wait on Him and to renew our strength.